Okay, today we are gonna talk about kernelized support vector machines. You might remember that we have already talked about linear vector machines as a linear model. Today we are gonna talk about kernelized support vector machines, and we are gonna learn how to apply this kernel trick. The next type of supervised model we will discuss: kernelized support vector machines. We explore the use of linear support vector machines for classification in linear models for classification 2 weeks ago. The kernelized support vector machines, which is commonly shortened as SVMs, are an extension that allows for more complex models that are not defined simply by hyperplanes in the input space. Remember, in linear models, we use the lines, right? Planes and hyperplanes to define the decision boundaries. While there are support vector machines for classification and regression for both tasks, we will restrict ourselves to the classification case, especially in this lecture. In Python, I am going to introduce the concepts regarding the class in type of SVC, support vector machine classifier. Okay, but how the similar concepts can be applied to vector regression is implemented in Python scikit-learn library. SVR, support vector machine regression. Okay, these are the side notes. The math behind kernelized support vector machines is a bit involved, so a little bit complex, and is beyond the scope of this course. So I will not give you the direct explanation of the mathematical formulations and their derivations, but you can check the Elements of Statistical Learning book, which I already share with you on the Moodle as an ebook. You can download and check the chapter one of this book if you are really interested in mathematics behind this kernelized trick. Okay, but however, here I will try to give you the main idea behind these mathematical formulations. So let's start. Now, let's talk about linear models and nonlinear features. So nonlinear features means that nonlinear values of the features. As you saw in figure 215, linear models can be quite limiting in low dimensional spaces. Low dimensional spaces means that less number of features. As lines and hyperplanes have limited flexibility. Here you see that we have only 2 features, which is a very low dimensional data set. And by using only a line to discriminate the red and blue classes, you cannot have 100% success rate because of you are using a line. But instead of using a line, if you are able to use a curve, basically what you can do, you can just try your curve by your hand, right? So you can try your curve like that. Do you understand? But this is a curve. However, this is a line. So you cannot put, you can try and see that. In some cases, by using only a line, sometimes you cannot be able to create a perfect classification. Okay. Or again, the other idea you can implement, the hyperplanes, right? So if there are 3, for example, it's not now here, if you have 3 or more features, you can try to create a hyperplane up or down you can look at this hyperabundant, and still you will not be able to fit into the data 100%, and it is expected, well expected. We have discussed this. One way make to a linear model more flexible is by adding more features. So we are using the feature engineering. That's why I try to make you understand the feature engineering in your last presentations. If you are gonna use linear models like to have higher dimensional data sets. It means that if your data set has few number of features, you need to increase by adding interactions or polynomials. Now I will explain this so you can think of that, how to do feature engineering as well. Okay, so to pay attention to these as well. So interactions means that we are gonna create some formulation in which we are gonna use the existing feature values to create new features by using a subset of features, or we can use a feature values, just one feature values, to create new feature values. Now let's look at these feature zero and feature one, two features, lower dimensional data set. As I explained, by using, for example, any line here, using a single line, you cannot create a classification for blue and red ones with 100%. Everybody sees that. So a line cannot do this. But by using a feature engineering approach, we can do. How can we do? Look at this data. We have the feature zero, feature one. But let me make mathematical senses. This is the X values. This is the Y values. So we decide by using the X value and the Y value. Let's say that we decide if it's a red class or a blue class. Okay, that's the idea here. And this function is actually just the coordination, right? So that's the X zero coordinates, and this is the Y zero coordinates, and this is the red class. Is it clear for everyone what we are doing? Actually, maybe it is changing with zero with 100. Maybe this is changing with zero with and 220 values, the Y values and the X values. For example, just to make it solid for you. Okay. Now let's talk about how can we create nonlinear features from the linear features. Nonlinear features. Nonlinear means that the relationship will not be look like a line. It will look like a curve. Let's expand the set of input features, say by also adding the feature one square. The square of the second feature is a new feature. So here we have the feature one, you see that, and feature zero. And let's say that I will draw here like that. Assume that our data set composed of only two. These are the feature zero and feature one. Let's do an example here. Remember that it is up to 100. It is up to 220. So let's say this point is, let's say 35, and let's say this is, I don't know what should be, this is 110, this is 55, 45. And now let me put the target class here, right? Now the target class, picking. The target class for us, it is blue. Let me write with blue. And we have, okay, so many examples in that set. So far, so good. Any questions? So that's our data set. But we can do this, increment this idea by adding a feature one square. How can we do? Let me show you. So instead of representing each data point as a two-dimensional point, here it's two-dimensional, feature zero and feature one, we now represent it as the three-dimensional point. Feature zero, feature one, and feature one square. So how can we do this? Basically, as a basic mathematics, you can just add, let me use another color for you. Here, any feature, okay, let's say this feature one square. So the feature one value is what? 45. The square of 45 is it's 160 something. So 100, 600 something. And we write this by calculation. Okay, now how many features we have? We have now three features. Okay. And after that, we can try to draw this three-dimensional graph. So for a sample, the blue sample, we have now this number, this number, this number as the coordinates or in three-dimensional way. Now look at this. Do you think that can we differentiate the blue and red classes by using a hyperplane?
Yes.
Yes, it's easy, right? Let me do it for you. For example, by using this hyperplane, right? You can easily tell me that if the coordinate is up onto this hyperplane, it's a red class, right? But if it is lower than this hyperplane, it is the blue class. Everybody sees that.
Yes.
Okay, so please pay attention that. Now we have the feature zero as in the original data set. And we have the feature one as in the original data set. And now we have the feature one square. We created calculating it from the feature one. Now we have three features. So we have the three-dimensional data set. Look, we have the three-dimensional graph. And by using this simple transformation, nonlinear, because getting a square is nonlinear transformation, right? So you can see that this transformation is nonlinear. Assume that the x values is 1, 2, 3, and 4. The y values, what will be? 1, 4. 1, 2, 4, 4, 3, 4, 9, and 8. So do you see that this transformation result is not linear? Everybody sees that? The x square is not linear, right? But if 2x we are going to use, it's going to be linear. We don't use this one. So we apply a nonlinear nonlinear, either it's logarithmic or it's an exponential. Nonlinear transformation to an existing feature to create a new feature. After that, we are able to separate these new data sets videos according to the target video with ease. That's the main idea. Any questions so far? Any questions? Okay, it's really important you follow all these transformations. So do you understand the nonlinear transformation and feature engineering? Okay. In the new representation of the data, it is now indeed possible to separate the two classes using a linear model, a plane in three dimensions. We can confirm this by fitting a linear model to the augmented data. So you see that by applying a linear class, now we have the boundary you see as a plane, hyperplane, but it's just now plane because we are in three dimensions. Okay, is it clear? All right. And then we can go back to the what we learned from here, the boundary dimension. We can go back to the two dimensions again. We decide to each point by only looking the F0 and F1 value, but we don't look F1 square anymore, but applying the same rule. Now you see that, do you think that the decision boundaries are still linear? Do you think that
polynomial.
The decision boundaries are linear?
No, it's just polynomial. No,
they are curves. Look at here. These boundary is not a linear, but actually it looks like curve. So actually, after only using after the transformation, if try to use the only two features, but applying the rules that we have learned here, now we end up with the decision boundaries drawn by curves. So you see that it's ellipse. Okay. The lesson here is that adding nonlinear features, so applying nonlinear transformation to the existing features, to the representation of our data set, can make linear models much more powerful than applied linear model to this data set on the left side. However, often we don't know, it's not easy actually, just apply the square. Remember that I asked you, why didn't you use the square root of the numbers instead of logarithmic transformation? Remember in the previous present? That was the question actually. So actually you don't know. You might need to apply. Maybe square root will also work for your case because it's also non-linear transformation. Logarithmic transformation is one example of non-linear transformation. Actually, there are many different non-linear transformations in the literature, but we don't know which features by applying this transformation and adding how many of them will help you to create a model that a linear model can solve it successfully. And try and see is very computational expensive. Therefore, we have a concept called kernel trick for that reason. So here the kernel trick tells us that to learn a classifier in a higher dimensional space without actually computing the new possibly very large representations. This kernel trick, by using this kernel trick, we don't need to create this F1 square from the existing F1. First need to calculate every of them, right? So you need to calculate this from this value, this value, this value, and assume that it's only one feature, but maybe you need to create many features. So it's taking time and computation expensive. However, the kernel trick does not require to calculate the new features, right? This is known as the kernel trick, and it works by directly computing the distance of the data points for the expanded features representation without ever actually computing the expansion. So basically the idea is that after calculating this, we try to create a model and put to, let's say, the blue and the red and calculate the distance from the this blue and red samples in that three dimension, right? That's our idea. After that, we draw a boundary line. Okay, so the kernel trick will provide you this distance without calculating the new feature values. It's very useful. Huh? You don't need to calculate the new features to find the distance between any two samples. That's names come from here, the trick. There are two ways to map your data into a higher dimensional space that are commonly used with support vector machines. The polynomial kernel, which computes all possible polynomials up to certain degree of the original features, like the feature 1 to the power 2 times feature to the power 5. Okay, so you can apply all these. So first of all, everybody knows the polynomial. So polynomial, remember A, for example, 1, let's put x, 0, A, plus B, plus C, plus D, plus I don't know, Z, X, N. So this is the polynomial up to some degree. The degree is here, N. Okay. And this is the one way of the using the kernel. Okay, this is one version, polynomial kernel that is. The other one is the radial basis function, the Gaussian kernel. I will not go into details of this. But understand that if I am talking about the polynomial kernel up to n degree, it means that a x to the power 0 plus b x to the power 1 plus c. So any a, b, c values could be, but the powers goes to up to n. That's the idea. Let me clear this. Okay, the Gaussian kernel is a bit harder, so I will not explain to details. One way to explain the Gaussian kernel is that it consists of all possible polynomials of all degrees, but the importance of the features decreases for higher degrees. So for the higher degrees, mean then x to the power n, if it is higher than the x to the power a, then its degree will be much more. So the you are multiplied by B value, which is higher than the A value. In practice, the mathematical details behind the kernel SVM are not that important, though. How an SVM with an RBF kernel makes a decision can be summarized, and we will do this. During training, the SVM, remember that SVM is a linear model. Don't forget, SVM, just a linear model, nothing else. Now, SVM learns how important each of the training data points is to represent the decision boundary between the two classes. Now, SVM tries to understand from given these data points, how each point, each sample is important to decide the target class. And then, SVM selects only a subset of these samples to create the decision points. So that's called support vector machines. Here the vector means that the samples selected supporting the decision boundary. Important to the decision. We are not going to use all the samples as we do in linear regression. Or in linear formula, we are going to select some of them only. So these support vector names come from there. I will show you in a moment as a graphic as well. To make a prediction for a new point, don't forget, we already select some samples. The distance to each of these support vectors, these samples, is the measure. So if you tried, for example, let me show you. If you select as a support vector mission these and these two samples as your decision points, support vectors, if you are gonna test a given point, if it is blue or red class, you are gonna just take the distance from the given point to these selected vectors. Because they are vectors, you need that they are the F1, F0 values. Then according to this distance to these two vectors, then you can make a simple decision. Okay, we are not gonna look all the samples, okay, in the data set. So the distance between the data points is measured by the Gaussian kernel. So the kernel means that it will calculate the distance for you without applying this F1 square transformation. It will not apply this, but it will calculate the correct distance in a higher dimensional space. Here you see that some formulation, but it's very simple. The X1 minus X2, there is nothing special. So, and the absolute values of it, then you get the square of the absolute values. You see that, if you like, I can go over here. So first you get the difference from the test point and the support vector x coordinates, let me say. Then get the square root of these values. So it is gonna be always positive. Then you multiply with the gamma parameter. So this gamma parameter called the width of the Gaussian kernel. And then you apply the exponential of these values and you come up with this distance number. Okay, that's the whole story. It's very simple mathematics so far. Now I would like to show you this. Now look here. This is the F0 and F1, feature 0 and feature 1. And please pay attention that this one and this sample in the training set are selected as support vectors by the SVM. So SVM thinks that these samples are important if you are gonna give a test point. By using only these 5 points, I will decide the test point, blue or red class. Do you understand this?
Yes.
That's all. But in a linear, other linear approaches, we will use all the samples in the training set. But in SVM, we are gonna select subset of these samples. They are called support vectors. Now, after selecting these support vectors, we can do and we can create a decision point in between them. And when we have a new test point, unseen test point, we can calculate the distance, as I explained in the previous slide, by using a Gaussian method. And according to the distance, we can tell that this sample is close to the red class or blue class. Okay. Actually, for me, it takes a little time to understand when first meet this SVM. I didn't make sense of these samples because it's called vectors and it's complicated for me. But now I understand clearly, so I try to make it clear for you. For that point, how can you write that point coordinates? You can write as, right? Whatever the feature point 0 and feature point 1 value. Let's say that you can write 5, and let's say 9. Actually, it is a vector because a vector is a number separated by commas. So you can put 5, 9. If there are another feature, let's say feature 2, so there will be another number 11, here 11. So you see that we represent a sample as a vector. Everybody sees that? Do you see that we can write down a sample in the data set as a vector representation? It's simple. Just putting a comma between the numbers. So it's called support vectors. Here are the supporting blue. This is the supporting red one. This is supporting red one. This is supporting blue ones. So if we have a new one, we are gonna check all the supporting vectors distances according to this point. Then we are gonna say that this point is close to the blue support vectors. So that is gonna be blue. Simple, right, actually? Do you think simple? Any questions so far? So do you understand each word in the SVM? The machine means here that the machine is creating the each support vectors, each selecting each sample from the given samples. So do you think that which one takes less time in calculations? The linear model that takes care of every sample, or the SVM only takes care of subset of the samples? Of course, SVM takes less time. In test. Okay. So if you calculate this, now pay attention that the decision boundary is not anymore a linear one, because we selected only some of them, not all of them, and we calculate the distance between them according to Gaussian calculation. Normally we calculate the distance, remember that, x minus, let's say that x minus x zero minus x one square, right? Like that. Remember that in Euclidean distance, right? And plus y zero minus y one square, right? In Euclidean distance, we do. But in Gaussian, we don't apply this. Okay. So in this distance, we have the ending with a line, but by using the Gaussian, we have ended with a curve. That's the power of the kernel trick. Okay, don't forget this. We are using the Gaussian calculation to calculate the distance between the samples. Okay. In orange, when you use the SVM, you have two options, of course. First, you can use the SVM with a linear kernel. So it means that the SVM try to find the distances between the support vector and the given sample by applying a linear calculation like the Euclidean distance. We have done this so far, but still selecting the support vectors. All right. But if you want to apply the kernel trick, you can select this kernel by this one of these three. It could be a polynomial, it could be an RBF, or it could be a sigmoid. Okay. And remember that here is G. G is the width of these calculations here. Okay. So you can apply a wider or stricter multiplication.
I have a question. Why do we have, we are multiplying with minus gamma here?
Actually, if you go into the details of the mathematics, you would understand that for the exponential, so exponential means that if it is the natural exponential, it's gonna be E. Okay. or if it's the nominal exponent, it's gonna be the 10. But if you put e, for example, square, what it means that? It means that 1 over e to the power. So this number will get smaller.
Yeah, I see.
Okay, so that's the idea. So you can do it smaller because the numbers are already big. You don't want to get this distance bigger and bigger. But we are be on the safe side, so we can make it smaller and smaller.
Okay. We are still exponentially transforming it, but it's not getting bigger, but it's getting smaller.
We are not applying any transformation here. We are trying to calculate the distances without finding the f1 square. You will not calculate these values. We do not calculate these values. We just try to find the distance between this sample to a test point without finding new features values. Okay? This formulation is for not converting to a new feature. This is the calculation for finding the distance between the support vectors and the given test point. Okay?
Okay.
It's really important. As I suggested, if you need more details about mathematical operations, you can check the Moodle. There is an ebook. You can check this ebook, statistical book. But I strongly suggest to follow the main idea. The main idea is that the starting idea is to apply nonlinear transformation and add new features, then calculate the distance, but it takes a lot of time. Instead, now by using the kernel trick, we will not add up new feature values, but we are adding up how to calculate the distance from the given test point to the selected sample points. So that's called kernel trick. Okay, it is faster. Because you don't have to calculate new features and then distance. We are directly calculating the distance to the selected samples, support vectors, by using some transformation. But this transformation gives us directly the result of the distance. Is that clear now, Ahmet?
Evet hocam. Yes.
It is really important, but really important. Okay. By using gamma, you can change this nonlinear transformation in the calculation of distance. Now you pay more attention to the nearest ones, or you pay less attention to the furthest ones. So you try to change the g value. And g value actually as a value looks like c value. Remember that? Or alpha value. Everybody remembers alpha value in linear and c value.
Yes.
This is the changing the capacity of the model. And by applying this g value, you can overfit or underfit to the selected vectors. Okay? That's important. So you see here the same idea. So we have the x1, x2 points. So you can calculate this Gaussian kernel, the distance between these. And this Euclidean distance is that part only, but we apply the exponential on it. So the number is getting higher. And when you apply the minus one, you are gonna get it lower one. Okay. The gamma parameter controls the width of the Gaussian kernel. It's called width, okay? It determines the scale of what it means for points to be close together. So as I explained that, you are gonna paying more attention to the nearer one or less attention, okay? So you will draw the line how it. So I will show a very simple idea. Assume that that's the, let me put the red point, and let's put the blue point here. So how you are gonna draw? So the basic idea always to draw like that, right? 50-50 away from each point, right? But we don't want the line. Maybe you want to draw like that. Maybe you draw want to like that. Maybe you are drawing like that. Do you understand my point? Or close to here, or like that. Of course, there are more than two. It's not only one blue and two blues, but there are many selected SVM. So this gamma will change how this line, the decision boundary will go over. So you need to try and see. In mathematical sciences, it's not easy, okay, to find the possible way, because it's up to you how to select the training parameter to underfit or overfit according to your data set. It's your responsibility. It's not just pure mathematics, okay. So here, let me show you. So these are some kernel tricks. These are the G value, okay? And you already selected the SVM. And pay attention that we have this C here again. As a linear model, you need to take about the C parameter as well. Remember that if C goes up, remember? So what happens? The capacity is increased. So it means that you can pay more attention to the minimizing the mean square error, not the regularization, okay? So you are gonna take care of these C and G parameters as well to get rid of the risk of overfit or underfit. Let's see how these parameters react to some sample data set. Now it's assumed that these are the R data set. Okay. I will explain step by step. Here is the capacity C is increasing in each column. In each row, I am sorry. So pay attention that these C values are increasing in that direction. And pay attention that the gamma values, okay, increasing in the column wise. These gamma values are increasing in that one. Let's look for the first one. First row. Now in the first row, capacity is 0.1 C parameter. So we don't change the linear model, but we are changing the gamma, how we calculate the distance. Do you notice that the the boundary line? Okay, this is the boundary line, right? Now look at this boundary. And now look at this boundary. What you notice?
What is much more complex. It's over.
Yes. When you increase the gamma value, now your trick tries to fit better to your samples, right? Is that right?
Yes.
Yes. So the complexity is getting much more. And when you increase gamma, your model will try to match or memorize your data. Is that clear for everyone? Okay. Now let's go to the other direction. Now let's pay the first column attention. Let's pay the attention for the first column. Now please note that in that column, right, we have a fixed gamma. We have a fixed gamma. But we are changing the C values. Okay. If you look at that in the first C value, it is just a line. In the second C value, we have just another line, right? And now at the very, very high C value, we have a curve. Do you notice that? And that curve fits more to the data. Everybody sees that?
Yes.
The second yes. point is that when you change the C value, do you notice that the number of selected points as support vector is changing? Do you notice that?
Yes, it's decreasing.
Yes, look at this. Now, here, every blue point and every red point is selected sector as a selected vector, right? Is it right? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
So they are all selected as support vectors because double, you see the double lines. But look at here. Some samples are not selected at support vectors. Do you notice that? These red and blues are not selected as support vectors. Now look at here then. Now we have selected few number of samples as support vectors. Do you notice that?
Yes.
Why?
But it's still increasing with the gamma. I don't see why it's happening.
Gamma is the same. Gamma is constant.
I mean, towards the right side.
No. I am talking about this column. Please do not go, otherwise you will get confused. Ahmed, follow with me.
Okay.
I am asking this first column. Do you understand that when the gamma is fixed, gamma is the fixed. When you change the C parameter, notice that the decision boundary becomes curve and the selected support vector gets fewer and fewer. Have you noticed that?
Yes.
Yes.
Because when you select less number of support vectors, then you are calculating the distance boundaries according to this one. Okay, that's the idea. So if you select all of them, the boundary will be linear line. Do you understand that?
Yes.
If you select all of them, then the boundary will be a line. But if you select some of them to calculate the decision, some of them, for example, for this point, you can only use this, and this to create the, if it is blue or right. You cannot use these ones. So you understand? But this is the C value effect. And we talk about the gamma effect. In the gamma effect, again, let's check that the number of selected points as the vector does not change. Do you notice that, Ahmed?
Yes.
Does not change. Only the calculation of the boundaries is changing. Do you notice that?
For the first row, yes, but the for the third row, it's changing the sample amount, at chosen sample amount.
Why? It's the same. Look at this.
I mean the support vector amount.
Gamma 10,000, all the same.
Yeah, okay.
So you are getting confusing. Please follow what you are checking for. You check this gamma the same. For the same gamma, you are always selecting the same support vectors. But when you change these C values, it's gonna change it. Look at this. Okay.
Okay.
All right. So don't forget the C value and the gamma value, how they change. Okay. It's important. So that's the idea why we have C and gamma values. Okay. So basically, gamma values makes the sub selections are much more overfit to the training, but the C values affects which points are selected as support vectors and then calculate the gamma distance, okay, the Gaussian distance. So you need to think of together now, not only one of them. So here are the some explanations again, let me go over. So going from left to right, we increase the value of the parameter gamma from left to right, left to right, left to right. A small gamma means a large radius for the Gaussian kernel, which means that many points are considered close by. So we take many points as the decision boundary points, so as a selected support vectors. Okay. This is reflected a very smooth decision boundaries on the left, boundaries that more focus on single points further to the right point. So if you increase the gamma points, now you are taking care of each of them to create a decision point. A low value of gamma means that the decision boundary will vary slowly, which is a model of low complexity. While a high value of gamma yields a more complex model. You can see that, right? To the right column, to the left column, rightmost and leftmost column. You understand that rightmost column, when the gamma is getting higher, is much more complex model. Everybody sees that?
Yes.
Going from top to bottom, the first row to the last row, the C parameter changing from 0.2, 0.1 to 1000. As with the linear model, a small C means that very restricted model, where each data point can only have very limited influence. Okay. You can see that at the top left, the decision boundary looks nearly linear, with the misclassified points barely having any influence on the line. So these miss points does not have any effect on the decision boundary. Increasing C is the bottom right here. Shown on the bottom right allows these points to have a stronger influence. So these two points, misclassified points, have now effect, much more effect on considering these into the decision points. Makes the decision boundary bend to correct these mistakes. You see that here, I will put, here we have a decision point, just try to make this blue belongs to the blue, and we have an island here, just to make this correct as a red one. Do you see that? This is because of the too much C value. Okay. You can apply this RPF kernel, for example, to the breast cancer data set, okay, by using this model. And this model is on the Moodle, don't forget. Now you can put the C1 and the gamma auto. You can most of the time will leave it auto. And now we have the SVM with 1.0 cost C and RBF auto. We have the test and train scores. And you see this distribution, so you can look at this distribution as I always suggest you to do in your analysis of data, okay? What we can see that here, now look at the orders, mean max values, pay attention mean max values. They have orders of magnitudes, different orders of magnitudes. Somehow is changing this small amount, and the other is changing very big, okay? This can be some of a problem for other models like linear models, but it has devastating effect for the kernel SVM. If you are using SVM model for that data set, you will be failing, okay? In a linear one or. And one way to resolve this problem by rescaling the features so that they are all approximately on the same scale. We are not transforming, but we are scaling. A common rescaling method for kernel SVM is to scale the data such that all features are between 0 and 1. So you can use the preprocess widget. Scaling the data can make huge difference depending on data set features values. So you can select here the normalize. There are many normalize methods, but you can select, for example, normalize to interval between 0 and 1. Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Can we use the interval minus 1 to 1 for SVM? Is it still okay for negative values?
The negative or positive values are not important. The scale of the importance, the values importance here, if you look at that.
I see. I just asking if it is not scaled down to 0, 1, it's scaled down to minus 1 to 1. Is it makes any difference for this?
Any of them can be selected from here.
Okay.
But you need to try and see. It depends on your whole data points, and it's not easy to say that this is the best one, this is not the worst one. It depends on your data set. So the data science is not a science, it is an art. You need to know the rules, but you need to apply and see the output, then change your decisions according to your some rules. But there is no strict rules. Do this and everything will be perfect. No, you are dealing with data, and data is collected from real life, and they are not complete. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, I see.
So you need to spend your time on data analysis. That's what I am trying to push you hard to do your presentations. Remember that? That's the point.
Yes.
You just don't just plug some models and expect everything will be okay. No, you have to spend your time preparing your data, as I explained right now so far. When training and test set performance are quite similar, but less close to the 100% accuracy, we can be suspicious of underfitting. We have discussed. We can increase either C or gamma value to fit a more complex model. Is it clear for everyone? So here you see that you can increase the C, and here you see that we have 99 in the training, but 95 testing. So it looks like that there is not enough test point. So you can increase this 10. Now it's 99.5, a little bit increase, but pay attention that the test score increased a lot. Okay, that's one version. Or you see that here is the auto. You can increase the auto to some point to increase or decrease your test success. You need to try and see. Okay. Kernelized support vector machines are powerful models and perform well on variety of data sets. But don't forget, these data sets should be preprocessed to remove the scale problems. You need to normalize the or rescale the features. Don't forget, either between 0, 1, either for some normalization, etc. Please check the 12-week lecture for normalization and scaling. I think everybody checked this. Okay. SVMs allow for complex decision boundaries even if the data has only a few features, okay? Because it's all automatically creating as if there are many features by transformation, then find the distances, okay? It does not use the distances provided by the features on we discussed. So therefore, they work well on low dimensional and high dimensional data, but don't scale very well with the number of samples. So it requires more samples to select the support vectors. Running an SVM on data with up to 10,000 samples might work well, but working with data of size 100,000 or more can become challenging in terms of runtime and memory usage. Why? Because it needs to apply this transformation and distance calculations for subset of these, and the subset of the data set will be increasing as the number of samples, so it will take much more time and memory. Another downside of SVM is that they require careful preprocessing, as I explained, of the data and the tuning of the parameters. Now we have two parameters, C and gamma. This is why these days most people instead use tree-based models, such as last time we have discussed random forest or gradient boostings. I didn't explain this, which requires little or not preprocessing in many applications. Furthermore, SVM models are hard to inspect. It can be difficult to understand why a particular prediction was made, and it might be tricky to explain the model to a non-expert, but remember in decision tree, it's really simple, right? Show the questions and the answers. It might be worth trying SVMs, try SVMs in your project, particularly if all of your features represent measurements in similar units. So a similar unit means that scale between 0 and 1, between minus and 1, like that. And they are all similar scales. And the important parameters in kernel SVMs are the regularization parameter C and the choice of the kernel specific parameters, in this case, gamma. We primarily focus on RBF so far, but it is there are several others, as I showed you. You can try and see this. You don't need to understand the details of the mathematics, but you need to understand the mechanism, how they work. Gamma and C both control the complexity of the model, with large values in either resulting in a more complex model. It's clear, I believe. Therefore, good settings for two parameters are usually strongly correlated, and C and gamma should be adjusted together. I strongly suggest that let the gamma be all auto, but you can change the C value. If it does not work, then fix the C value, then change the gamma value, not at the same time. We are gonna see the begin to see the unsupervised learning in the next lecture. Do you have any questions?